iOS 15 and iPadOS 15 preview. The good, the bad, and the weird. Hello, lovely YouTube family. Welcome back to Tech IQ. In today's videos, we are going to talk about iOS 15 and iPadOS 15 preview. The good, the bad, and the weird. Before we start, I would want you to hit that red subscribe button so that you never miss out on any of our videos. The bad. The first public beta of iOS 15 and iPadOS 15 is here. This is the software that will run on millions of iPhones and iPads when Apple releases the final version this fall. But you don't have to wait that long to sign up for the iOS 15 beta and install it. Yes, that will give you an early look at new features like live text, FaceTime on Android, and new privacy features. But if you're on the fence, let me offer you some advice. Wait. Yes, the installation process only takes a few taps on your iPhone screen, and yes, you can go back to iOS 14 at any time, but before you jump on the iOS 15 beta train, there are some important things to know, especially if you have only one iPhone or iPad. Some iOS 15 bugs will be too much to deal with. A beta is called that because it's not finished and there are bound to be issues. For example, the second beta of iOS 14.7 includes an issue that causes some iPhones to not recognize the SIM card inside the phone. Without a SIM card, your phone may as well be an iPod Touch. Bugs and issues just like that will surely crop up in iOS 15 and iPadOS 15, and even if they don't completely stop you from using your iPhone or iPad, the bugs will still be annoying and could mean the difference between getting work done and reliably sending messages and having a paperweight. The weird. Whenever Apple makes major changes to the operating system and the underlying APIs the developer uses to build new features and services, it typically means that older developer tools are removed or how it works gets changed. Even a slight change can cause an app to no longer work at all. A couple of years ago, I was testing an iOS beta and I couldn't use my bank's app. It would open and then immediately force quit. Thankfully, the developers were able to release an update that took care of the issue, but that's not always the case. And just because during beta 1 all of your apps works fine, that doesn't mean that beta 3 won't break them. If there are apps you rely on daily, it's better to wait until closer to the official release before joining the beta. The good. A major rethinking of either platform, this year's updates are not. The two updates were clearly born in 2020's norm-shattering pandemic. The feature list at WWDC and on Apple's website wears last year's remote-first influences firmly, from the heavy emphasis on FaceTime features to a better system for corralling notifications into work and personal buckets. Of course, Apple's release cadence and insistence on major updates coming just once a year means that some of these features are arriving in what will, hopefully, be a post-pandemic return to life this fall. So it'll be interesting to see how things like SharePlay, one of the update's marquee features, actually shake out once people have the option to watch movies and listen to music together in person again. Other parts of iOS and iPadOS 15, like the overhauled Safari app or the new Maps app, feel like the kinds of more noticeable changes generally associated with Apple's major software updates, but they're sporadic. The result is a software update that feels a lot quieter than Apple's usual releases, one that at least for now looks to improve smaller things behind the scenes than rebuild things from the ground up. SharePlay in action. And since content is streamed locally, everyone watching or listening has to have access to it, meaning that you can't share an episode of Ted Lasso with a friend who's not on a TV Plus subscriber, nor can you both watch the same movie if only one of you has purchased it from iTunes. FaceTime is also getting a wide variety of long overdue updates that help cement it as a more viable video chatting application, a sorely needed grid view, screen sharing, a portrait mode to blur your messy background, and the ability to FaceTime with Windows and Android users in web browsers, thanks to shareable links. These are all badly needed features for FaceTime, but they're also the sort of things that remains bewildering to have had to wait until September 2021 for, especially given the reliance on video calling over the past year and a half. Unlike SharePlay, though, the FaceTime improvements feels like the kind of things that will remain front and center even as things start to go back to normal, although the Apple product focus and more limited features set when compared to professional solutions like Zoom or Microsoft Teams mean that FaceTime won't be making a play for business meetings anytime soon. And that's all for today, folks. I hope you liked the video. If you did, make sure to hit that like button and subscribe to the channel so you'd never miss any amazing videos from us.